Et puis on passe à Elisa. Donc Elisa, et on passe en anglais en fait. Elisa is a tenure track researcher type B at the University of Ferrara. She just concluded a Marie Curie fellowship at the University of Reading on the reception of Virginia Woolf in Italy. She authored Il Paese della Bellezza with Educat in 2007 and L'Indimenticabile Artista with Vita e Pensiero in 2015. With Davide Vago, and this has already been mentioned, but it's worth going over it again because it was a very good number. She edited an issue of L'Analisi Linguistica e Letteraria on Eco-Criticism and Eco-Discourse in 2016. She is co-founder and vice president of the Italian Virginia Woolf Society. Today she is going to be talking to us about Svevo and Woolf. Lisa, over to you.
Well, thank you so much, Daniel. Can you hear me well and can you see the screen?
Yes,
Okay, thanks.
we can hear and
Yes,
we can see
thank
the
you. That's
screen.
great.
Yes.
So thanks to you and of course thanks to Davide and thanks to Benedicte and to Ileana Guzman and to Professor Marisa Verna for organizing this great event eventually after so many months. Et je m'excuse si ma présentation est en anglais et pas en français, mais mon français c'est trop rouillé après 20 ans que je ne parle pas français. Donc, ce sera en anglais. So, modernism and zoopoetics have much more in common than one would imagine. Animal studies, for example, share with modernism the impulse to question enlightenment ideas and knowledge, subjectivity, and language. Modernist authors indeed struggle to find a way to represent the true inner self, the one that is not visible from the outside, with a gaze much similar to Derrida's cat in his famous essay, L'animal que dont je suis, intruding in his intimacy and forcing him to think about who he is, how he uses language, and what role he plays in the definition of a human animal. Among the few scholars who have discussed the relationship between literature and zoology in the early 20th century, I find Caroline Hovhaniak's work particularly interesting. In her Animal Subjects, Literature, Zoology, and British Modernism, she reads modernist writers as a zoologist and vice versa, suggesting that both groups worked to find a balance between matter and language, a way to attend to both the animals they observed and the many possibilities for representing them. In my analysis, I will share Hovhaniak's approach, which considers how modernist writers found animals' differences from humans aesthetically compelling. And I'll do this by examining two works by Virginia Woolf and Italo Svevo. Even though I'll open quoting The Gaze of a Cat, I will not investigate cats, though, but two literal dog. Flush, the Cocker Spaniel protagonist of the eponymous novel by Woolf, and Argo, the protagonist and narrator of Svevo's novella Argo e il suo padrone. Both works, published respectively in 1933 and in 1934, came out after a period which saw a thrive of dog autobiographies in Europe, a genre which found its origins in the new animal psychology based on Pavlov behaviorism. As Joella Jacobs explains, the topos of the narrating dog became of particular interest around 1900 with the rise of the phenomenon of language skepticism. Modernist writers were acutely aware of the inability of language to represent anyone's perceived reality accurately, and they struggled with the arbitrariness of signs and their reference. Despite being very different literary works, Flush and Argo il suo padrone share some common elements. First of all, multidisciplinarity, as they can be both considered as works of literature, ethology, and animal psychology. There are not so many studies in this sense on Argo il suo padrone, but Flush has been read both through the lens of ethology and of animal psychology, and Jean Dubino and Derek Ryan explored ideas of human-canine coevolution and multi-species entanglement in the novel, end of quote, which is both a biography of a poet told from a different perspective, and a book about species difference, about the mutual strangeness on non-human and human. Secondly, they're both parodic of a genre, Flash of Victorian biographies and Argo of 18th century apologues. Well, Wolf Flash indeed plays with the genre of Victorian biographies by overturning the construction of biographies of eminent and exemplary figures, which it does by narrating the life of a dog, which reveals all human fragilities and corruptions. This is, of course, a joke that Wolf made, both with reference to her father, who was the director of the Dictionary of National Biographies, so the very Victorian monument to biographies, and to her friend Lytton Strachey, who revolutionized the idea of biographies with his Eminent Victorians. The dog Flash is indeed described as an eminent Victorian to tell, through this perspective, the life of his mistress, the portress Elizabeth Barrett Browning. Like Flash, Argo e il suo padrone is an experiment in different genre too, at the basis of which is the ironical satire apologue, which was in fashion in the 18th century and which was used in Italy by Giacomo Leopardi in his Operette Morali. In this genre, animals are zoomorphic and their role is that of telling the truth, the thought of the author. Argo, too, however, overturns the confidence and optimism of the 18th century ratio, which was typical of apologues, to tell about incertitude, the fallacy of reason, the lack of clear and final explanations. Much modernist issues, indeed. The third element they share is the switch from human to non-human perspective and the multisensoriality which characterizes this shift. I will mainly focus on this third aspect, trying to answer three more specific questions. First of all, do the two writers try to resist anthropomorphic constructedness in the narration of their non-human characters? If so, what kind of narrative expedients do they or do they not enact to underline similarities and differences between their human and non-human characters? And third, is the underlying presumption of the two writers that language is the only only linguistic language, that l'humain ne pouvait parler que de l'humain, ne s'apprécier qu'aux humains, to quote Anne Simon, or are body language and scent-based cognition described as diverse and alternative but equally valid forms of communication and reciprocal understanding? Well, to do so, I need to first make a step back to consider how Darwin's evolutionary theory radically dissented human and how this had a strong impact on zoology and animal studies in general. Between the last decade of 19th century and the first decade of 20th century, there were many bioscientific and behavioral studies on animal language. In her The Animal Mind, Margaret Washburn cites hundreds of studies published in biology journal between 1900 and 1926, trying to answer questions about animals' cognitive abilities, learning processes, sensory perceptions, and conscious experiences, thus proving it was a field in intense development. The most famous study concerning a talking dog was certainly the one which took place in Germany on the Airedale terrier Rolf, who was claimed to have been able to perform arithmetic and communicate with humans on an intellectual level, and whose story is a declared inspiration for Argo e il suo padrone. Wolf as well apparently places her novel in the fashion of dog novels, but while Svevo, although with reversed roles, draws from the literary fashion of the philosopher dog, in which canny narrator eloquently mastered the human language, Wolf plays with the very British and Victorian tradition of illustrious biographies, as we said. Since Argo e il suo padrone is probably less known, being a minor work in Svevo's oeuvre, it probably needs a short introduction. Svevo wrote the novella in 1926, and a first version was published in 1927, but the more definitive one was published in 1934, curiously, the same year in which Flash was published in Italian by Mondadori, as Wolf's second novel to be translated into Italian. Argo's master, whose name the reader ignores, is spending long and boring days in forced isolation on the mountains for a year with his dog. But then he reads in the news of a talking dog in Germany. Although the name of the dog is never mentioned, it is of course a reference to the Airedale Terrier Rolf. The master thus closes the newspaper and convinces himself that his dog too is perfectly capable of learning human language and that Argo sapeva parlare e taceva solo per ostinazione. I provided the English translation for your convenience. He starts teaching him his language, but instead of Argo learning Italian, it is the master who eventually learns canine language. The motivation he gives, however, it seems quite not anthropomorphic, but the motivation he gives is particularly interesting in the light of animal studies. As he says, il mio primo intendimento era stato di insegnare ad Argo l'italiano. Come prevedibile, apprese di più l'essere evoluto. The reader thus discovers that he or she is going to read Argo's autobiography, which Argo dictated to his master in canine language, and that his master then translated from canine to Italian. Well, this seems to answer the third of my preliminary questions. So is the underlying presumption of the two writers that language is only linguistic language? Apparently, it is so for Svevo, but is it for Flush? Differently from Argo, Flush does not act as narrator in the novel, and his language is not directly anthropomorphized in order to make it intelligible. He is simply described as a purebred dog who, like his mistress, emancipates and gets rid of the Victorian patriarchal constrictions when he moves to Italy. But how did Wolf enact this? After the first earthquake in human beliefs derived from Darwin's theories, a second crisis of scientific knowledge and values came with the advent of psychology, as we know. Once the scientists were understood as humans with human senses and human psyches, science could no longer be considered as absolute and objective. Modernist writers faced this by proposing the idea that multiplying perspective was the best path to knowledge, and studying animal perspective was one of the ways to work on this multiplicity. This because animal psychology aligned with modernist concerns such as the belief in a plurality of perspectives, the exploration of consciousness, and the need to denaturalize our own point of view and see the world through different eyes. Timothy Morton suggested humans should not look at animals from a distance, but jump down into the mud with them, a practice that helps cultivating love for all species, but which is easier applied when we live with animals, since they help us to jump down on our four legs to appreciate the world from their perspective. This was precisely the case both for Virginia Woolf and Italo Svevo, who had dogs for most of their life, and who enact this plurality of perspective by opening their narration with a two-legged human perspective to then switch it to a four-legged canine one. Woolf's opening, in fact, ironically recalls British literary tradition, since it reflects the very well-known incipit of Pride and Prejudice. And the narrator then starts by explaining, with a very imaginary philological explanation, completely fantastic, the origins of the Spaniel breed, although it's all an excuse, of course, to set up an historical tone, although an historical one, of course. Argo, on the contrary, opens with the master's preface, who explains what we are going to read and why. So a bit more, I wouldn't say scientific, but you know, a bit more philosophical, before leaving the floor to Argo. Apart from their love for their own pets, it is worth understanding the influence of animal psychology studies on their work. Argo, for instance, makes a reflection on his excrements, which is aligned with contemporary cynophile education, absolutely ahead of time, so in 1926. And this proves that he had a knowledge in dog psychology. The figure of the philosopher Bertrand Russell is also particularly interesting for what concerns Woolf. In The Analysis of Mind, Russell developed a philosophy founded on sensation and perspectives that extended concept borrowed from animal psychology to the human animal. In so doing, he reconceptualized the physical world through the language of senses, claiming that it is sense data rather than matter, that is the substance of the world. He argued this through the example of a table that is, in fact, a series of related sense data and not a single consistent object. Well, it is well known how Wolff was influenced by such theories, and it's clearly evident into The Lighthouse, where Lily Briscoe, the painter, thinks of Mrs. Ramsay's work. And it is exactly the example of the table she makes, and I quote from To the Lighthouse, "Whenever she thought of his work, she always saw clearly before her a large kitchen table. It was Andrew's doing. She asked him what his father's books were about, subject and object and the nature of reality, Andrew had said. And then she said, heavens, she had no notion what that meant. Think of a kitchen table then, he told her, when you're not there." Russell's influence of Wolff, which has been deeply analyzed by Anne Benfield in her work, which is significantly titled The Phantom Table, was twofold, however. Not only Russell influenced Wolff with his theories, but he himself was influenced in return by Wolff's research on human psychology and her experimentation with prose. Russell applied animal psychology to humans in order to create a vision of the human that is more in accord with modernist versions of subjectivity, of which Wolff was, of course, a perfect example. Another influenced scholar was Conway Lloyd Morgan, a prominent figure in early animal psychology and animal behavior studies, who studied under Charles Darwin's protege. In Animal Life and Intelligence, he assumes that all animals, humans included, mentally construct their ideas of object based on sense stimuli and memories of earlier sense stimuli. Morgan refers to plural worlds, saying that it is not merely that the same world is differently mirrored in different minds, but that they are two different worlds. And he claims that the question we should ask is not how does the world mirror itself in the mind of the dog, but rather how far does the symbolic world of the dog resemble the symbolic world of man? In Morgan's view, it would be wrong to assume that humans have objective knowledge of the world of which dogs one is just a subset. He proposed instead that both humans and dogs make up their own worlds that are differently mediated by the subject's biology. Russell too preferred the word worlds to describe the things around us, as it emphasized the fact that there is not one single objective perspective. These visions seem to be better shared by Wolff than by Zwevo. As a matter of fact, while Argo's world is bent to become describable and translated in human terms by his master, Flash's world remains that of a dog, and Wolff, as narrator, does not try to humanize or to translate Flash's feelings into human ones. Argo's narration, or at least his master translation of it, let's not forget that this is a translation, and so we should consider it as such, presents example of metacognition, the awareness of one's own thought processes, which was only recognized in dog, partially recognized in dog, in 2018, and it was thus considered a merely human capacity in 1930s. Argo says, for example, things like ebbi qualche di esitazione or mi parve di sentire, up to more general statements like solo Argo soffre, in tutto il mondo che è bello e lucente non c'è altra sofferenza, or again, talvolta Argo è lieto e vuol bene a tutti, taglia l'aria con la coda perché in lui manca ogni sospetto e sa che non c'è nessuno che voglia pigliarlo per quella parte inerme. Argo's metacognitive considerations sometimes even make of him a philosopher, like when he claims that pensare alla catena quando si è liberi sarebbe come diminuire la grande gioia della libertà. Flash, on the contrary, is not transformed into a thinker himself, a philosopher, okay? It is the reader who transforms what Flash does into a philosophy of life, but he remains a creature of sensation and instinct, and I'm quoting from Hovenek, of which the narrator tries to interpret thoughts and feelings, but from the outside, as I said. Flash, for example, keeps interrogating himself instead of searching answers. And so the reader doesn't get the sense of metacognition in reading about Flash. Both Hardo and Flash, however, mostly live in what Wolf calls the world of smell. And they both have an olfactory philosophy, science, and religion. Argus One directly refers to the dog philosopher genre and to Kafka's investigation of a dog. And he indeed opens his autobiography stating that there exist three smells in this world, only to then list five different smells because Argo, contrary to Rolf, knows no arithmetic. To explain the relevance and importance of smell, Argo even comes to the philosophical statement that his master calls futurist, odori tre uguale vita, which I translated as smells three equal life. It's my try. The representation of Flash's consciousness is much less enigmatic and more grounded in the mundane, embodied everyday life of dogs. So what kind of narrative expedience do the two authors enact then to represent these two worlds? As said before, Hovhaneck suggests that Wolf's conception of animal experience closely aligns with the idea of animal psychology, and she argues that one of the techniques Wolf uses to represent Flash experiences is delayed decoding, a term invented by Ian Watt to describe Conrad's impressionist techniques. This is a literary device in which the narrator relates an event not through facts and description, but through sense impressions without explaining the event meaning. And this is precisely what happens in Flash, where the narrator relates the dog's sense impressions, merely smells, and it is up to the reader to decode the event and its meaning. An example is when Elizabeth Barrett goes shopping with Flash for the first time, and we as readers have a very different perspective of the experience, which for Flash is confused, multiple, and overwhelming. Flash entered mysterious arcades filled with clouds and webs of tinted gauze. A million airs from China, from Arabia, wafted their frail incense into the remotest fibers of his senses. Swiftly over the counters flashed yards of gleaming silk. More darkly, more slowly rolled the ponderous bombazine. Scissors nipped, coins sparkled, paper was folded, strings tied. What with nodding plume, waving streamers, tossing horses, yellow liveries, passing faces, leaping, dancing up, down, Flash satiated with the multiplicity of this sensation, slept, drowsed, dreamt, and knew no more until he was lifted out of the carriage and the door of Wimpole Street shut on him again. Well, the later decoding is found in Argo too, when Argo witnesses a crime probably committed by his master, but only do the reader realizes that what has really happened. Argo, in fact, tells about a man he saw going down a ravine, not walking on his leg, who stopped at a brushwood. Then, and so this man was probably rolling down the ravine. Then the next day he could feel he smelled like a crowd of killed animals he surely laid in his own blood. And after a few days, the stench was shouting and reached me to the chain, which got even more disagreeable than usual. The day after, the stench was sparso per il sentiero per cui ero sceso il giorno innanzi, lo scopersi già sulla strada maestra su cui c'era persino una goccia di sangue che egli non aveva potuto portare seco. Ed io risalì sulla traccia di quell'odore ed ero tanto immerso nel mio lavoro che non sentii il fischio del padrone. Sulla strada mi trovai improvvisamente dinanzi al padrone. Non mi picchiò, anzi socchiuse gli occhi ed aperse la bocca ed io dalla gioia dimenticai l'uomo. Così appresi che certe bestie, anche dopo morte, possono tuttavia fuggire. So we know in this way that his master probably hides the corpse of the man. In this switch of perspective, another element worth noting is the use of synesthesia, always used to describe smells, which are alive and shining, I quoting, for living things, like the shouting stench, l'olezzo che gridava, in this passage, and black and boring for objects. The main difference in this switch of perspective between Argo and Flash is that Argo's narration is made in order to elevate Argo to the level of humans. Flash, on the contrary, is downgraded by what he learns from human, because it is human who have taught him to feel jealousy, anger, despair, and thus veined his flesh with human passions. To recall Morton's and Russell's notion of different worlds, Flash enacts such plurality in the different interactions he has with other dogs, first of all, which is an interaction made purely by desire and instinct and free of possessiveness, jealousy and anxiety, and with Elizabeth Barrett Browning, marked by fidelity and jealousy. Argo, on the contrary, experiences jealousy, rage, and anger, not only towards human, but also towards other dogs. So there's not this distinction of different worlds, but more, you know, the writer tries to make the two worlds more similar with regard to this aspect. There would be a lot to say about the different relationship between the two masters and their dogs. Argo is frequently beaten by his master, and he spends his days chained outside the house, while Flash is loved and treated like a child, so much so that he is extremely jealous when the real baby is born from Elizabeth and Robert Browning. Time is over, however, and I will just recap my initial questions. So to answer the first point, even though Svevo's novella results narrated in the first person by the dog Argo, both dogs have no linguistic abilities, but they still have that anthropomorphized animal language that usually questions zoopoetics' own presuppositions. Anthropomorphism is often considered a literary device flattening diversity in favor of a human-only perspective. But it can be as well a way to make animals more understandable to humans in order for readers to realize that they demand an ethically equivalent response and sense of responsibility from humans. I'm quoting from Ferris. I think that this is the case for Svevo and Wolf, who in fact use anthropomorphic narrative expedients such as delayed decoding to represent the animal world as a perception capable to shake up their culture's assumption and the place of humans in a world inhabited by much more species than just humans. And this partially answers question number two. The third point has already been touched, but again, there would be a lot to say about how Wolf, adopting the voice of the biographer, confronts the limitation of human senses and human language in understanding and describing the full extent of Flash experiences. Or about the syntax used by Svevo to reproduce a dog's mind. Wolf's challenging comment in Flash is probably the best way to save words and close my talk, opening the floor to discussion, also in the light of Pascal's Amiot presentation about poetry. Even the most sensitive of poets cannot find words for the sensations a dog feels. So, merci bien.